Hey guys, first of all, I just want to tell you I miss you so much. This is just such a weird time, but I've been thinking about you guys a lot and I'm really missing you. So, anyway, I thought one way we could kind of connect is for me to read a little bit of our story from Poppy. And the book's still at school, so I'm reading it off of Owen's Kindle. And if you remember, we left off, and Poppy was coming up with a plan to go to Newhouse to find out what is bothering Mr. Okacs. And she hasn't left yet. She's about to tell her dad. Remember, his name is Lungwort. And I'm going to read a little bit tonight, and then I'll read a little bit every couple days, okay? So this is Chapter 8, Poppy and Papa. From the moment Lungwort pulled the curtain across the entrance to his boot study, he did not show himself. When anybody asked, the curtain was opened by Sweet Cicely, but just a fraction. Looking out just long enough to say, "He's not well," she would draw the curtain closed. Now Poppy stood before the study, working up the courage to speak to him. She kept asking herself, as she'd already done 100 times, if she really wanted to go to Newhouse. The answer, plain and simple, no. Just the thought frightened her. But still, she was convinced it was the only way to prove that she and Ragweed were not really the cause of Mr. Okacs's refusal. Nonetheless, she feared that when she told her father about her intentions, he would be displeased. So with a sigh, she braced herself and called, "Papa?" Her mother peeked out from behind the curtain. "He's not..." "Oh, Poppy, it's you." "Mama," Poppy said, "can I speak to Papa, please?" "Well, if anyone, just make it short." Poppy slipped into the boot. "Is he still ill?" she whispered. Sweet Cicely nodded. "I've never seen him looking so poorly. He just lies there whimpering. Though every once in a while he'll shake his head and sob, 'What are we going to do?' or 'It's all over with us now.'" Poppy's heart sank. "Poppy," said her mother, "I do hope you're going to tell him something that will cheer him up." "I'm not sure I will," Poppy confessed. Her mother sniffed. "Well, then, you'd best know what else he keeps saying." "Yes?" "He says if only Ragweed and Poppy had asked permission." Poppy's heart sank even further. "And I must agree with him," Sweet Cicely went on. "But if you insist on seeing him, come along." Lungwort had curled himself into the absolute toe of the boot, the gloomiest part. His tail was wrapped around his feet, his whiskers were limp, and his front paws were in constant motion as if squeezing a sponge. Poppy thought his fur had grown grayer, too. Sweet Cicely leaned over. "Lungwort, dear, it's Poppy. She's come to visit." Lungwort shook his head and mumbled as if holding an argument with himself. Poppy came forward. "Papa," she said. Lungwort looked up and stared at his daughter. "Doomed," he said mournfully. Remember, here's a picture of the boot that's his study. "Doomed," he said mournfully. "Who is?" "The whole family." "But if rules aren't followed," he began, but stopped to shake his head. "No, it's my fault." "What do you mean?" "If I had raised you properly, you would never have gone to Bannock Hill without asking permission, and none of this would have happened. I accept full responsibility." His tail swished in dismay, and he started squeezing his paws again. Poppy appealed to Sweet Cicely with a look, but her mother was gazing piteously at Lungwort. "Papa," Poppy said, "I have an idea that there may be another reason why Mr. Okacs refused us." Lungwort sniffed. "Huh, you're too young to have ideas." Poppy didn't protest, but she pressed on. "Papa, I think Mr. Okacs refused permission because of something about Newhouse. Something he doesn't want us to know." Lungwort considered his daughter for a moment. And suddenly his whiskers stiffened and he bared his front teeth. "That ragweed," he snarled with anger. "He twisted your mind. He's the cause of all this." Poppy stepped back as though struck, but she managed to say, "I'm going to try to find out." "How?" "I'm going to go to Newhouse." Lungwort turned limp again. "Why tell me?" he said with a shrug. "You don't care what I think. You're just going to go anyway." Poppy wanted to say something kindly, but the words would not come. And instead, after a painful silence, she turned to go. Suddenly, Lungwort cried, "Poppy?" "Yes, Papa." "Whatever you do, watch out for porcupines." Poppy lay upon the floor of her log cabin syrup room and studied a map of the area. As far as she could see, there were three ways to reach Newhouse. The easiest would be to go along the tar road, but if she took that route, she'd be traveling in the open. That was reason enough to rule the tar road out. The longest way would be to go around the marsh, but that meant going over Bannock Hill, and it held too many painful memories and fears connected to ragweed. Nope. Poppy was not ready to go there again. Not yet. Her third choice was Dimwood Forest. Few mice who had ventured in had returned to tell of their experiences. Even so, the dark woods seemed to offer real advantages. She could travel midday, even in bright sun. Mr. Okax and most other creatures would be asleep then. And if and when the need arose, the same light would enable her to find a hiding place. If the forest had anything, Poppy assumed, it would have plenty of places to hide. Yes, she would go that way. Poppy told only Basil about her plans. If she succeeded in discovering the real reason for Mr. Okax's refusal, there would be time enough to let everybody know. On the other hand, if she discovered nothing, who would know or care if she disappeared? She asked Basil to meet her at the back steps of Gray House when the sun was at its highest the next day. That morning she mingled with the family so none would suspect what she was up to. But with so many convinced that she was the cause of the crisis, the hostility made it too painful to wait. Sometime before her appointment with Basil, she was pacing by the back steps, ready to go. "I'm leaving right away," Poppy announced as soon as her cousin appeared. "You forgot something," he said. "What?" "This." Basil held out Ragweed's earring. "For courage," he said. Poppy held still while her cousin gently fixed the earring to her ear. Then she shook her head, and it tickled her ear. "I need a hug," she said. As they hugged, Basil whispered, "You know, I could go with you." Poppy broke away. "No, it has to be just me," she said. And she leaped off the back steps. "Why? If I'm the one who caused this mess, it has to be me who sorts it out." "Well, good luck," Basil cried after her. Poppy, not wanting to look back because she thought it might make her lose heart, dashed away. That's chapter 8, guys, and I will read another chapter very soon, and you're not going to believe what she finds in the forest. What do you think is going to happen to her? And what do you think is hiding at Newhouse? We'll find out more next time. Bye, guys.